Hello and welcome to Big Game Bound alongside Jarrett Payton. I am Chris Hagan. We are coming to you live outside of SoFi Stadium. And Jared, let's start with the bad news. This weather has really disappointed. 71 degrees right now. You're coming from Chicago. I'm coming from Indianapolis. At least for right now, it feels good to be here, doesn't it?
It's amazing to be here, Chris. And alongside you, this beautiful weather, now we have an opportunity to break down this big game that's coming up on Sunday.
Now, it's been 2 years since we've been face-to-face. We've talked via Zoom every week with Peyton's picks. But nice to see the world getting back to normal. You're down for the Super Bowl, a big week for you and the family. So feels like we're going in the right direction, and it's nice to see something like the Super Bowl that was so very different last year.
Yeah, a lot of people are just excited about being back out, coming to see the game, and here in LA, you can tell, especially when you have one of those home teams that is here playing in their home stadium, people are excited, and this week is only getting started.
Yeah, let's take a look at the matchup. It will be this Sunday right here at SoFi Stadium. For the second year in a row, a team playing on its home field. That is the LA Rams. They are a slim favorite over the Bengals, who somehow, someway, the Road Warriors getting the job done. And it was all led by young Joe Burrow at quarterback.
At the end of the day, your mindset stays the same. You know, when I played in the state championship in high school, it feels the same as playing in the Super Bowl does now. Just, you know, at that moment in my life, that was the biggest game that I had ever played in. And, you know, so the everything kind of feels the same. I've just had more reps in those situations, so I'm probably even a little calmer.
Very calm indeed, Joe Burrow. Joe Cool, as they've been calling him. I mean, what can you say about this guy? He got that catastrophic injury. He comes back, and here he is on the biggest stage in football.
I mean, you watch him play, and it's amazing to watch it, such a young talent, especially at the quarterback position, Chris, have such an outlook of being more like a vet, the way that he plays the game. But I think it comes down to when he was in college, he played in big games, won a Heisman. He's been in those big time moments. So when those times kind of arise, it's never too big for him. He always, even when the lights are bright like they are right now, still he's cool, calm, and collective. And he's got some swag to him. And I think that's what's really helped kind of carry this Bengals squad all season long.
How much does that matter as a player yourself when you get in that huddle and you see that confidence or that swag from your quarterback? Does that really mean something, especially when the game's on the line?
Oh, it does. It means probably everything. When you have a guy that you know is your signal caller, he's the guy that is calling plays, and he's cool, everybody else has to be cool as well. I played with Ken Dorsey, Steve McNair, guys that when it came down to big time moments, they were there to be able to take advantage of those situations, but they calmed everybody else around them, and the reason why on those teams we were successful.
You were high on these guys early in the season in Peyton's picks. You would pick them to win games where I thought, JP's crazy. They would go out and win those games. Something to be said about how he's conducted himself and kind of really not you know, feeling like we just heard from him. He's going to treat this like any other game. That's just a special trait to have in a quarterback.
It really is. It's a special trait when every team is looking for a guy like Joe Burrow. Everybody wants a young quarterback like this, and especially you're doing this rookie contract. That's what every team wants now as well. You want these quarterbacks coming out of college, giving them opportunities to be able to play in a game like this where you don't have to pay them so much, and I think it's really helped around the offense that they built around him as well. They have all the pieces that you want to be able to win a championship.
What impressed me was when he sacked 9 times
it doesn't
by
matter.
The Titans, and he just kept playing the next play.
I know. You start looking at how many yards he passed for, over 300-some yards, had the interception in that game, but still, defensively, they came up on top, and so it's kind of been back and forth for this Bengals squad. When the offense needs to be able to make plays, they do it. Defense, when they need to step up, especially against KC, they did that as well, and the reason why they're getting a chance to be able to play up against a Rams squad, he's going to have some – you thought that Titans defense was nice? He's going up against a Rams defense that is pretty solid.
He could get sacked 20 times, who knows, come Sunday. Well, obviously, the quarterbacks, right or wrong, they get all the attention, they get all the credit, they get all the blame. On the other sideline, you've got Matthew Stafford reborn out here at SoFi Stadium. All those years in Detroit, could never win a playoff game, never had the opportunity, and yet here he is, also another great story. He's found his way to the biggest stage in football.
Yeah, I mean, everybody wanted to see what, this Rams team could do. They needed a quarterback. Can they figure it out? Stafford comes in, Sean McVay, those two together are like poetry in motion. They figure each other out, yin and yang. They can finish each other's sentences. Now he's got some talent around him as well. You add in Odell Beckham Jr. coming over from Cleveland. He's kind of fit into the puzzle as well. So now they can run the ball. They can throw the ball on the outsides. And we're going to talk about Cooper Kupp. He is one of the phenomenal talents in the NFL.
It was strange. You know, sometimes, I mean, you go where you get drafted. You play where you get, you know, where you're sent. He was in Detroit. A team, a franchise that's had so much trouble. I always thought he was one of the best quarterbacks, you know, top five, top ten in the league. And now he's really proven. He's been doing his thing kind of in obscurity in Detroit.
He's when you look at his numbers, Chris, Hall of Fame caliber numbers. He just doesn't have the trophy to go with it. This is going to be his opportunity to get that trophy, to be able to – he's a Hall of Famer. This right here on Sunday, if he wins, it solidifies that all, because when you look at his numbers, what he's done, and you can't count a Matthew Stafford team out. 34 comeback wins in his career. That's what you want to see. They're never out of games. They'll find a way with him underneath center.
Yeah, and you think about that quick drive at the end to advance. He had his swagger too. You know, he wasn't like, let's go play for overtime. He's like, no, I don't care about you, Tom Brady. I don't care. This is your last game. We're gonna go win this thing. And you could tell he had built that confidence. You get that first playoff win. It was amazing how that snowball was heading downhill and it was looking to stop.
Hey, I'm gonna tell you something. He's got veteran swagger. It's a little bit different than Joe Burrow's. He's got veteran swagger. He's seen a lot. Maybe he hasn't played in the big time games, but still, he's played in meaningful games. Anytime that you step out on the NFL field on a Sunday, Monday, or Tuesday, or Thursday, you have an opportunity to go up against the best of the best. He's seen it all. Now he's got the pieces around him. I think defensively for him, he feels a little bit more comfortable knowing that he has Aaron Donald and company that can kind of, if they do make a mistake, that they can get stops and he can go out and play free. But when you got a bunch of guys, you got a running game that's working as well, anything is happening with this Rams offense. They're pretty lethal.
We talked about how the quarterbacks get all the credit or all the blame, but they don't do anything without those guys up front, the offensive line. We're going to be bringing you some special interviews all week long. Let's kick it off with one of the best of the best. You talked to one of the big uglies up front.
Yeah, when you have an opportunity to talk with a HOFer and a guy that is one of the best at the left tackle position, Anthony Munoz and I, we had a chance to sit down and talk right before I came here to L.A., and he's talking about how he's excited to be able to see his old team back in the big game.
I got to ask you, because a lot of people, I just got chills down my arms. How does it feel to have the Bengals back in the big game in the Super Bowl?
I tell you what, Jared, it's been a long time. Since I tell people, Cincinnati is such a great sports town. And, you know, it's been a long time. When the last time we were here was when I was playing. So that's a long time ago. But the city's just been hungry. I mean, the city, week one of the playoffs, it was just crazy. And it's getting crazier every week. So the fact that we're in the Super Bowl, man, people are just, they're wearing Bengal stuff to work everywhere, more than I've seen in a long time. So I'm happy for the fans. I'm happy for, you know, the coaching staff and these young guys that are just playing over the top.
You know, when you look at this team, it's anchored by that big man, Joe Burrow, man. How impressed are you with him and how he's played in his second year?
I tell you what, you know, his coach in college, Coach Ogeron, I got to know when he was at SC, so I've known him probably close to 20 years. So I've watched LSU quite a bit. I don't say that too loud with my son being a Tennessee guy, but, you know, and I watched every one of Joe's game his senior year, and it was like the bigger the game, the better he played. And then all of a sudden when we drafted him, I'm thinking, this is going to be cool to watch this young man. Hopefully he can continue to do what he did in college. And Jared, it's amazing, his poise, his smarts, his calm, and it's like the bigger the game, the more poised he is. And, yeah, I think this guy, you know, has a long, long career. Again, we know injuries are a factor, but keep him healthy. He can be here for a long time leading this team. But, man, I tell you what, he is a fierce competitor. You know that it's his team, and you know the guys just love playing for him.
Well, I heard you were at Penny Sewell camp before the draft. Has Ja'Marr Chase changed your mind a little bit?
Yeah, I've been talking you know, I've talked to my guys. Keyshawn Johnson and I have talked two or three times since then. You know, how can Chase not change your mind? I mean, the guy is a game changer. And, you know, it's been so much fun to watch him. And, of course, I'm still, you know, the O-line's done pretty good. But and I'm sure Frank Pollock, the O-line coach, will get him ready for the Super Bowl. But I still think that's a position that we'll address in the offseason. But, yeah, it's Burrow to Ja'Marr Chase has been phenomenal. And then, you know, you can't overlook, you know, Boyd and Higgins. I mean, Chase gets 400 yards and Higgins gets 1,000 and Boyd gets 800. So pick your poison. And I'm hoping that Uzama is healthy enough to be back for the Super Bowl. He hurt his knee a little bit, but the guy's amazing too. So they've surrounded Joe with some pretty good weapons. And he's quite familiar with Chase from their college days. So that's been fun to watch.
Yeah, the one thing with the Bengals is they can run the football. They'll figure out to be able to pound it on you. But when it comes to pass protection, that right there probably is the biggest key heading into this matchup. Do you think that that Bengals O-line can hold up against Aaron Donald and company?
Well, I tell you what, you know, he's the – I haven't seen two guys block him, let alone one guy block him. And then they got Von Miller, who seems to be energized, you know, and then they got several other guys that are just – they've got four guys that can bring it. So, you know, I'm sure the offensive line knows that this game rests on their shoulders, and they're going to have to do it. I mean, it's not like, you know, you can dip into the, you know, the free agent or the practice squad and get anybody. It's, these guys are going to have to do it. You know, Prince is going to have to stand up and play the right tackle, and especially the guys inside. You know, you got young guys playing inside with, you know, it depends if Carmen's playing or Adeniji's playing. There's some young guys. Spain's a veteran guy. But in Hopkins, but yeah, they're going to have to strategically put them in a position the way they, you know, set the pass protection. And then, you know, the guys that are manned up, they're just going to have to get it done.
Yeah. It's not going to be easy, but you know, it's no. possible. Listen, you get to this point and it gives you an opportunity to play for that Lombardi Trophy. You know more about playing left tackle position than anybody that I know. And can you believe that Andrew Whitworth is still playing at the age of 40?
That's amazing. You know, that was one person that I hated to see leave Cincinnati, not only because of his high level of play, but who he was in the locker room and the community. I got to know Andrew. He was on one of my foundation committees. Just an amazing guy. And to see him at the age of 40, still, my body starts to ache when I think about playing at the age of 40. You know, I was 35 when I retired, and you know, another 5 years, it's like, oh man, I watch him playing. I, you know, I'm not even playing and I hurt a little bit, but he's done a phenomenal job. It, you know, kudos to him. I mean, Witt is just, has been a phenomenal player, but even a better person.
Well, I know you say your body hurts, but I still feel like you could be out there putting in some work. But listen, the work that you're doing off the field though is probably even more important. Your foundation has helped over 50,000 kids throughout scholarships, camps, tutoring services. Why is this so important to you?
Well, Jared, you know, it's one of those things. A lot of it, I think motivation, incentives, you know, the way I was raised. You know, my mom raised five kids by herself, working 2-3 jobs. We didn't have a whole lot, never had a car, very little at times, but she loved us. She provided for us. And then coaches, teachers, organizations stepped in and provided, you know, for me to really chase the dream. And I'm thankful that you know, after high school, I got a scholarship to attend a school and play football at USC. So people stepped in, and I wanted to use my platform because we know, you and I know, there's a lot of talented young men and women out there, but all they need is maybe their confidence built, maybe an assistance and maybe getting some money for scholarship or trade school. And I wanted to put a team together to do that. And we're entering our 21st year now with the Anthony Munoz Foundation. And I just tell people, I'm just a member of a bigger team now. You know, I was a sports team, not as many people, but now this great community. You know, I keep using sport analogies with my foundation staff, and I got a couple of small companies. I hope they don't mind. But I keep saying, the bigger the team, the bigger the impact. And we've been able to put together an amazing team here in the tri-state area. And you mentioned some of the programs, you know, mentoring, overnight character camps, leadership seminars, scholarships for seniors going to college. And last year was probably one of our best years in the last 10 years coming out of COVID. And I'm thankful to our corporate partners, my staff, my board members and volunteers. And then we have a lot of interns, local college students. So again, just a member of the team, man. You know, the only thing is my name's on it, but I'm just a team member, and I don't take a penny. I'm referred to as the senior intern because I don't take a penny, but it's a passion, and we'll keep going and hopefully do it for a few years. And but it's one of those things where we're now seeing college graduates coming back and coaching our camps and, you know, mentoring and, you know, running great businesses, and they get it. They're speaking at our camps. They got jobs with corporate partners here in Cincinnati that are partners of the foundation. So that's what it's all about, seeing these young people be successful after high school. And if they go to college or trade school, and then once they become productive citizens, business people in the community, that's what it's all about.
We all need more role models in this world, and you're one of them, but you're also creating leaders with your foundation as well. I wanted to ask you, what does the Walter Payton Man of the Year Award mean to you?
Well, you know, it's funny because that was going to be my next thought. You talked about role models and, you know, to be a former winner of, I think you know a little bit about Walter Payton, and to have, I have his award up in my family room with several others. It means, I mean, that award is probably one of the most important because it encompasses who you are as a person. You know, I'm all pro, all this, all that, and that's just football. But this is who you are as a, you know, a father, a husband, a community member, a player. So, I mean, that trophy sits up there, and when I watch the games and stuff, I always kind of sit up and look up, and there it is right there, the Walter Payton Man of the Year. And it means a whole lot. And, you know, I got to know your dad really well. And I got to share this story. My daughter, Michelle, who is, I think, maybe just a little younger than you, you know, we had this thing in D.C. It was kind of a roundtable thing, and I pulled her out of kindergarten, took her with me, and your dad and I were sitting. We weren't involved in the roundtable, so Michelle was sitting right between, you know, Walter and I, and we got home, and that's all she talked about. Your dad made Michelle feel like a princess. I mean, she was like everything, and the way and that's how he treated everyone. I always knew when your dad was around, because somebody has always come up behind you and hug you, and it was like the bear hug, man. And I say, Walter, please, man, I can't breathe. But yeah, it means a lot to have to be the NFL Walter Payton Man of the Year. To have that is just amazing.
That's awesome, man. I know you grew up in LA, man. Went to school at USC. Well, I'm guessing you're still rooting for the Bengals, though. So what is your prediction on Sunday?
Well, you know what? I think, and I've said it all along, all year, I think we can play with and beat anyone. And I think this is the year of the Bengal. I think this is the year of the Tiger. And that long drought, we're going to end up after Sunday being 1-2 in the Super Bowl. And I'm going to predict that either Joe Burrow or Ja'Marr Chase are going to be the MVP of the game.
How cool is that? Talking, like you said, one of the best of all times. He played for the Bengals. They're in the Super Bowl. He went to school out here at USC. This is a match made in heaven for him.
Oh, this is, and he is looking forward to it. And just the fact of looking at the matchup with someone that, you know, is a Hall of Famer that played the game, this is one of those moments for him that he's sitting back. He gets a chance. He said, feels like he could still play a little bit, but he's going to sit on the sidelines, watch it like everybody else.
It's amazing. You see some of these Hall of Famers, and they get a little bit older in years, but so many of them – they're just special people. They'd still look like they could go out there and make some plays, even though, I mean, you got the guns. I could at least get two carries out of you, couldn't I?
Two carries? Come on, goal line? You could put me down goal line package anytime. I'm scoring something at least twice.
Let's be real, though. If you went in there and Aaron Donald hit you, I think you'd be okay maybe with one carry. Remember how hard it feels to get hit in an NFL game?
Yeah, I remember. I remember back in practice, though, as well, because I came from NFL U. So if you remember, getting hit by Sean Taylor was no easy thing. But, yeah, watching these guys on this field, they were going to be on Sunday, and looking at some of just the athletes, this is one of those matchups, especially on the offensive side of the ball, where you got a lot of guys that can go get it. And I'm talking about chunk yardage, explosive plays with both quarterbacks in their arms. So hopefully this could be something where we're sitting back and we're not just watching a defensive battle, but hopefully maybe we're seeing some explosion on the offensive side.
When you think about some of the playoff games we've seen already, we got a little spoiled. This Super Bowl has a lot to live up to. Yeah. You talk about the Bengals first. I mean, Ja'Marr Chase, Joe Mixon, all these guys on an offense. It's not just Joe Burrow. He comes into a good situation. That's that franchise, let's face it, had been drafting pretty high for a while. Yeah. They've got some weapons on an offense.
Yeah, but to me, Chris, it comes down to the running game. So when you look at Cam Akers and you look at Joe Mixon, what both guys do for their offenses, they create, and not only just in the run game, but also in the pass game as well. If you can find ways to integrate them, run the ball here and there, 5 yards, now you're having these defenses have to put 8 or 9 men in the box, and I think that's what makes both of these quarterbacks so special, because they can take those shots down the field, and they connect on them as well. And so that's what's going to be interesting to see, how both these teams are able to run the football.
I joked about getting 9 sacks for Burrow. I'm sure it was no laughing matter for him. No. He's in the tub after that.
Cooper Kupp. He is one of the phenomenal talents in the NFL. He was the FCS Walter Payton Offensive Player of the Year. Had a chance to meet him, and then he ended up losing, I think, the next year to a guy from Sam Houston State. And I remember walking up to him going, "You're going to go to the NFL?" He goes, "Yeah, I'm going to work my tail off. I'm going to try to do this. I'm going to try to get there." And I looked at him and I said, "Hey, man, work hard." And guess what? Now he's one of the best receivers in the NFL. So it doesn't matter where you come from. If you find the right spot, you land in the right spot, you work hard, things can happen to you like they're happening to Cooper Kupp.
Now, you're always such a positive guy. You make me feel good about myself when maybe I shouldn't. Now, when you were saying to Cooper Kupp, you're like, "All right, kid, you work hard."
Yeah.
Or were you thinking like, "Hey, this guy could do it"?
No, I didn't know. I mean, I watched a little bit of film on him, Chris. I'm going to be honest. I was like, he's probably not going to make it because you just don't know. But you don't know what's going on inside of someone's heart, man. And if they're working hard and they're grinding it out, anything can happen. And he has really fell into a good spot. But he doesn't. It doesn't matter how much you put on his plate. He doesn't care. He's going to – and what you're trying to do defensively, he'll take advantage of that. And you always have to have your eye on him, which that's the hardest part. Once everybody's eyes on you, you get double coverage. You still got to make plays. He's been able to do that this season.
What's interesting to me is there was a time when Odell Beckham Jr. was – the gold standard for wide receivers. He comes into a Rams situation where Cooper Kupp's putting up all these numbers. How does that make life easy for Odell Beckham? And we saw he had an explosive game already in these playoffs.
Because now you got to pick and choose as a defense, because you're starting to see Odell Beckham come in here, feel more comfortable with the offense, and now you got to find a way to be able to double him. One guy's going to be on, and I think that's what makes offenses so dynamic, Chris, when you have two guys that can go get the ball that are hard covers. Those two guys, you got to pick and choose. Pick your poison. Guess what? One of them is going to burn you.
We think about, the playoffs is where you make your name, where you make your legacy. I'm thinking about what's going to happen in this stadium on Sunday, because there's been so many names out there. Now, I know the MVP for the NFL, that's for the whole season. But if we had to name an MVP just for the playoffs, what we've seen thus far leading up to the Super Bowl, who would get your vote?
I mean, I'm going to take the quarterbacks out of it because they get all the love like we were talking about early on. I probably have to be Cooper Kupp. I mean, his what he's been able to do and how much I think this Rams offense leans on him to be special and for him to be able to be special throughout these playoffs, he would get my vote.
When you think about Super Bowl week, it's so different now than it was 10 years ago, 20 years ago. I'm curious about your father. By the way, I don't know if we mentioned this. Your dad's Walter Payton, if you've ever heard of that guy.
He was all right.
What does he share? Did he share any Super Bowl memories about what it was like for him? Or did he seems like the kind of guy like, "Hey, just give me the football. I don't care if we're in the backyard of the Super Bowl. I'm going to go play."
Well, guess what? He played probably his worst game of his entire life in Super Bowl 20. So his memory, I remember talking to him. It was more just about all the people that wanted tickets. Because it was in my mom's hometown, like being in New Orleans. Everybody wanted tickets, and he could only get so much. But he remembered, he talked about the parties and hanging out with my mom's side of the family and all of our family being together and how special that moment was. So I know it's a lot different now for these guys, but I hope that they have an opportunity to kind of cherish the moment, because you just never know if you're going to get back here ever again.
That's what's so crazy is sometimes you'll see a guy as a rookie and he plays in the Super Bowl and never goes to one again. Yeah. You see guys that have long careers, never get into a Super Bowl until the end. And you think about all these Hall of Fame quarterbacks that have only won one Super Bowl. These guys that have only played in one Super Bowl. Some guys that have never even been to a Super Bowl. Like you said, you need to enjoy the moment, but realize that this isn't guaranteed ever again.
No, it's not guaranteed. And I just got chills down my arms, because these are the moments that you work so hard for, Chris. Everybody wants this opportunity. They don't get it. Had a chance to talk with Eddie George, a couple weeks back. He talked about how, man, it was great to be there. I thought I was going to go to a more. He never went to another one. So you got to take advantage of this opportunity that you have. And I think both sides are going to do that. But you just never know if you're going to get back here. And hopefully you never know if you're going to be able to hoist that Lombardi Trophy.
We're going to have several guests all week long. You want to give a little teaser, some of the people we're going to have on?
I mean, we got a lot of people. Sean Alexander, we got Barry Sanders, we are going to have Paulie Papps from the Dan Patrick Show, Stacey Dales from NFL Network, and you got a handful of guests as well. So that's just what we have in the bag. We're probably going to get a lot more interviews.
Yeah, we're going to have Chuck Pagano. We're going to have Edgerrin James from the U. From gold teeth to a gold jacket. He's got a new book out. We'll talk about that. Edgerrin, always great on the field. Always a great conversation off the field.
He's my hero.
I was waiting for JP to throw up the U. We're going to talk to Reggie Wayne. He's up. He's a finalist again for Hall of Fame induction.
So what are you, just going through all the Miami guys?
All these Miami. I just got in Jared's phone and went through the Rolodex. Now, I'm sure we're going to change our mind How old am I? I said Rolodex. Good grief.
Yeah, you are.
Let's not talk about that. By the way, I did babysit Jarrett like in 1982 or something like that. He was a little kid. The last time I was taller than him. I'm going to change my opinion probably 25 times before kickoff. But right now, as we said, the Rams are a slim favorite, like three and a half, 4 points. I'm going to take the Bengals. I just feel like they're a team of destiny. It's a great story, whoever wins. I like the Bengals right now. Now, when I talk to some Rams folks, that might change my mind.
I'm not giving you my pick yet because Peyton's picks is going to come up by the end of the week. So we're going to keep that kind of hush-hush. But, yeah, you can't go wrong. I think when you talk about teams of destiny, there's a reason why this Bengals squad is here, man, and they're a good football team.
It was funny. It's around the league. We talk to people all around the league, and some people, you know, they just hate the Steelers or they just hate the Raiders. I don't know anybody that just hates the Bengals.
No.
Or hates it. So I'll be happy for whichever team wins. So those aren't the teams we cover on a daily basis. Yeah. But both of these, you know, we talk about how they make movies out of things, incredible stories. Both of these would be a great movie. And, of course, we're here in Hollywood.
We're in Hollywood, so the script is perfect for the L.A. Rams. But, yeah, for this Bengals team, too, a lot of Bengals fans that have grown up that never have got a chance to be able to see them at this point. This is a huge moment for this franchise. And what better to have as a great quarterback, a young quarterback, and Joe Burrow to help you kind of maybe hoist that trophy.
I couldn't even get him to lean one way or the other.
I'm not
going to. The early
Peyton's
pick.
Picks.
Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to change my pick every day. And then whoever wins, I'll have our camera people pull that clip and play it back. And I'll say, see, I told you on air. So I'll be right either way. We're going to have a lot of stuff coming up. We're just getting started. But for right now, JP, throw out the Twitter handles for the Twitter follow.
Oh, at Payton Sun, PaytonSun on Twitter.
And I'm at Chris Hagan Indy. That's Hagan, all A's, just like my report card was when I was a little kid. We're going to have fun all week long, guys. We're just getting started. We're out here outside SoFi Stadium. I'm going to try to hit the gym, get my guns up like JP, because on purpose he came to embarrass me. And the good news is, since we've been here, the temperature has gone up 2 degrees.
Oh, let's go.
We're going to get the sunscreen. We're going to be ready. We'll be here every day. Check the Twitter for the start time. We come to you live, and then you can watch it at your leisure, maybe when you're off work and don't want to get in trouble. But for right now, that's Jarrett Payton. I'm Chris Hagan, and we are no longer big game bound because we are here getting you ready for Super Bowl 56. We'll see you next time.